Taste and see how God cares for you. No one believes. or a slice of bread and be good for the whole day until the next day. You got me to eat again? So I have to stop what you're telling me, but I have to stop what I'm doing. Maybe I'm at work or I'm cleaning my house or I'm watching TV. I have to stop what I'm doing and go get more food. To go to my kitchen and make another meal, or I have to go to McDonald's and get a sandwich. Or maybe if I'm at school, I have to go down to the lunchroom and get my lunch. Am I in the store and get something? Well, that's kind of mighty inconvenient, because I'm a busy person. And I have to just stop and get something to eat throughout the day. It cuts into my day. But it's something I guess I have to do. Because what happens if I don't eat? What do you think will happen?
He brought it up, and it grew up with him and with his children. He used to eat of his meager fare. light dark. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flocks or herd to prepare it for the wayfarer who would come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the guest who would come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, this man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives in your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife from your wife, and killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite from your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house. And I will take your wife before your eyes and give it to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wife in the sight of the very sun. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan said to David, "Now the Lord has put away your sin, you shall not die. Nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly sworn the Lord, the child that is born you shall die." Our New Testament lesson today comes from Ephesians chapter 4, starting at verse 1. "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to be one holy in your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high and made captivity itself captive, he gives gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended from the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind and doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speak the truth in love. We must grow up in every way to him who is the head of Christ, for whom the whole body joined and knit together by every ligament, which is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth and building itself." The gospel text today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, starting verse 24. "When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got out of the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, 'Rabbi, when did you come here?' Jesus answered them, 'Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal.' Then they said to him, 'What must we do to perform the works of God?' Jesus answered them, 'This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent.' So they said to him, 'What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat.' And Jesus said to them, 'Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the bread from heaven. For the Whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts may be accepted in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One of the great joys I have found in life is that when you put something away in a special place or a safe place and you can go back later and get it, one of the joys I have found in life is that when you go back to retrieve that item, you find it's not in that special place that you put it. Or it probably is, and you've probably forgotten where you put that item. It's one of the great joys in life because then it begins a mission of looking for that item. You start to look and look for that item. Now, it would be wise if you really didn't need that item to give up 30, 45 minutes of looking. But I don't know about any of you, but sometimes it becomes personal. And you just become bound and determined, I'm going to find that item. If I have to tear the whole house apart, I'm going to find that item. So you look and you look. This happened to me a couple months ago. I was trying to fix a computer problem, and I was looking for a computer disk that had a utility on it that helps fix the boot sector of hard drives. So I was looking and looking, and after 30 or 45 minutes, I couldn't find it. And so I should have just given up and gone on the internet and found the utility and downloaded it. But I told myself, no, I put that with other discs that I might also need, giving myself an excuse to make it personal. So I kept searching, and one of the other great joys of life occurred, and that is, I don't know about you, but when I'm searching for an item that I put in that special place that I can't find, and I search for it, almost inevitably I come across something else that I was searching for, something that I couldn't find, and that's what happened in this case. I found something I had been looking for, I had been looking for a year before that and never found. Eventually, after a couple hours, just gave up. And as I had it in my hand, I thought, maybe I should put this in a special place so that I won't forget it. And then I realized I might as well put it back because when I need it again, I won't remember where I put it. But after much searching, I did in fact find the computer disk that I was looking for. It's amazing what we search for in life. In our Old Testament lesson today, we have the completion of the story where David did something very heinous. At the zenith, at the top of his power, both internationally and within Israel, he decided in just one moment that the laws, the regulations, the commands of God didn't apply to him. They applied to everybody else, but they didn't apply to him. So when he saw a woman who was beautiful, he went and fetched her. And even when he found out that she was married, that didn't stop him. And he thought he was pretty clever, and he searched to cover this up, and he sent her away. It looked like everything was good, and then she turned her finger. And so David again searched again to try to cover this up by bringing Uriah home and making it seem as if it was Uriah's child. But Uriah, because of his faithfulness to those fellow soldiers in the field, who were living in tents and eating rations of the day, he wouldn't go down to his house. He wouldn't part. And so David decided again to search for another way to cover this up. And so he decides to kill Uriah by sword. And so he sends a message to Joab, the commander of the army, to put Uriah in the hardest fighting and to pull back so that he will indeed be killed. And David hears the news that Uriah was killed. And then after Bathsheba makes her mourning period, David comes and gets her and makes her one of his wives. And it appears to David that all of his searching has paid off. He has covered this all up. But of course, God sees exactly what David did. It's interesting that David, who wrote so often the Psalms about how God sees everything, of course, forgot at this time that God saw everything. And so God sends the prophet Nathan. He tells David's story. He says there was a certain rich man. He had so many flocks and herds. And he lived next to a man who was very poor, had almost nothing. Nathan says that this rich man received a travel. And according to the law of Moses and the customs of the day, if you receive someone like this, it's your responsibility to feed them, get them some water, and to give them something, some place to stay for.
Nathan tells David, when this rich man received the visitor, he didn't want to take from what was his to provide food for him. So he stole from the poor man what little he had. And in our scripture text today, you can just see the anger of David mounting against this rich man. And he works off in a special kind, righteous law of indignation. And he declares, as the Lord lives, this man deserves to die. Instead, he paid back fourfold because he had no pity. And of course, Nathan tells David, you are the one in this story, David. He said, God gave you so much more than anyone else. God gave you all these things so that you could serve the Lord and serve the people. And instead, you took what someone else had and made it your own. And of course, David realizes he's been caught. He realizes, of course, his sin. And Nathan tells him that your sin has been put away, but there will be trouble for your kingdom from now on. David was searching for a way to cover his sins and his misdeeds. He thought he had it, but it came undone. It's interesting what we will search for in life. In our gospel text today, Jesus has just fed the crowds with fish and loaves. And he and his disciples went to the boat and they went away. And when the crowd realized they weren't there, they went looking for him. And eventually they caught up to him. And so they asked him, Rabbi, teacher, how did you come here? And Jesus sees through their question. They're not interested in seeing him because of miracle signs and wonders. They're not interested in seeing him and hearing him preach. They don't want the secrets of the kingdom of God. They want round two of the fish, the loaves. So Jesus tells them, do not labor for that which perishes, or for that food which gives eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. Now it's interesting that Jesus puts it that way. Do not labor for the food, because those people hadn't labored for the food that Jesus had just given them. They hadn't done anything to get the fish and the loaves. They didn't buy anything. They didn't spend any time fishing or farming or making the bread. Jesus gave it to them, as we recall, for free. So why is Jesus talking to them about laboring for it when they got it for free? I think Jesus is pointing out to them that it wasn't for free. They had labored to get the fish and the loaves. Not in the traditional sense, not the way we normally think about it, but they went out to see Jesus. And they went out to a place they wouldn't normally have been. And they listened to Jesus for a long time. They invested a whole bunch of time, energy, effort, even imagination, so that they could be in that time, in that place, where Jesus performed the miracle. And here again, they've spent all kinds of time, energy, and imagination searching for Jesus. And so Jesus is pointing out, you are investing already. You are giving of yourself. I'm simply asking them, what are you getting in return? What is it that you want in return? All this investment. And it reminds them, don't invest yourself for that food that is going to pass away, the food that will give you eternal life. And of course, this sounds good to the crowd. Who doesn't want eternal life? So they ask him, what works must we be doing? He tells them, believe in me. And so the crowd says, okay, if we're supposed to believe in you, what sign, what miracle are you going to do so that we can see it and we believe? And then they cite this passage where, of course, God gave the Israelites manna. And the people say, Moses gave manna from heaven. Now, why do they cite this story? Well, the manna that God gave the people of Israel didn't last one day or one meal or a week or months. It lasted years and years and years. So they're basically challenging Jesus. It's a sneaky way to get back to the point where they want to be fed. Sneaky way of getting back to that and saying, okay, Jesus, what sign are you going to do to feed us again so that we may believe? Now, I have some sympathy for the crowd, or empathy, as the case may be. I think I was 10 years in ministry when my father pointed out to me that I knew of every pizza joint within so many miles of my home, and that their home pastor knew of every dairy queen within so many miles of his home. So I have some empathy for the crowd looking to get something to eat. But But of course, Jesus is telling them there's something even more important in life than that. They were looking for the food that would nourish for a little while. And Jesus was offering them something that would last them forever and ever and ever. And yet, what were they spending all their time, energy, and effort on? What were they investing in? Get something to eat. Again, it's interesting what we will work and labor for, what we will seek for in life. In our New Testament lesson, the Apostle Paul lays it all out bare for us. Why are we in this world? Paul says. The answer is, he says, we're here so that we can believe in Jesus Christ. Paul says, that's the reason we are here. That's the purpose we are here. And he says, not only that, we're to believe in Jesus Christ so we can receive the Holy Spirit, so we can open ourselves up to the Holy Spirit, so the Holy Spirit can work in our lives to mold and shape us. Why? Paul answers that question as well. Paul says the goal is not for us to be spiritual babies who constantly have to be fed and taken care of. The point is that we become spiritual adults so that we become useful. We become useful to Christ in the world. We become useful to other people. We grow up into that fullness of maturity in Christ, Paul tells us, so that we can be members of the body of Christ. For a baby can never be a member of the body of Christ, as Paul is talking about, because there's no way that the baby can help the body build itself up, equip itself for the work that we have been given. Paul lays it all out. Why are we here? We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in Jesus Christ and we receive the Holy Spirit. We receive the Holy Spirit so that we can be molded and shaped, so that we can grow up into spiritual adulthood, so we can be useful to God in the world. Getting back to our gospel lesson, the people were following Jesus and investing all sorts of time, energy, imagination, and effort into getting something to eat. And the Apostle Paul is telling us what we really should be investing our time, energy, and effort into. What we should really be searching for is that relationship with Jesus Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit, and spiritual growth in our lives so we are of use to God in the world. As Jesus told the crowd, it comes down to, what are we searching for? Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and teaching us and helping us to understand what is vital importance, what is eternal importance. But all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Please be seated. The ladies are looking for a covering for the art show for the quilt. The covering can be a large umbrella or easy to put up canopy. They need something to cover the quilt, obviously, in case it rains. Any other announcements? Yes, Brenda? Lord God, we thank you so much for the blessings that you've given us. We thank you for the fact that, as David sent away so long ago, and what you've done, you have put our sins away as well. We thank you, Lord God, for this great and wonderful gift that we are now sinless before you because of what you've done for us. We also thank you, Lord God, that your plan for us was to be part of the work that you were doing in the world. That you have a place and a plan for us. There are spaces in your plan that we are called on to fill. We thank you, Lord God, that you have given us not only great love and forgiving our sins, but that you have given us a purpose in life. Spirit, you will open us up to understanding how we are serving, how we will seek to make others' lives better in our world. We pray, Lord God, also for our congregation and our community. We pray that you will be with each one of us, that you will bless us with your Spirit and your guidance. We also pray this day, Lord God, for all those who know who are going through difficulties and struggles. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with them in a very special way. Now let's take a few moments to pray for those who are concerned about it.
Lord.